I always thought about harming myself.
I'm shy. I struggled with making friends.
I never thought I could do anything. I have extremely low self-esteem.
Lately, I've been eating my pain away. Just throw it back up. I've been struggling to lose weight.
Somebody said I don't fit in just because I wear my hair the way I like it.
1 out of 5 American girls suffer from mental health problems. Don't be that girl. Talk to someone.
Those thoughts I had are long gone, for I have a future I need to get to.
In order to get better, I had to do better. I learned how to make friends.
I believe in myself. That's when everyone else did, I set an example.
Instead of me eating everything, I started watching my calories. The weight is falling off.
I wanted to change my hair, but I decided it was for me. It's for me.
A PSA from the Curvy Girl Project.
And good morning. Welcome to Exposé Under the Sun, sponsored by the Detroit Native Sun newspaper. I'm your host, Darwin Griffin. And we have a very informative show for you today with my special guest, Ms. Alicia Johnson. And before we get started, our show is live. Our calling numbers are area code 313-868-0342, 313-868-0351, 313-868-4336. Excuse me, and you are watching us live from the phenomenal cities of Detroit, Michigan, under the auspices of the Honorable Mayor Mike Duggan, as well as the phenomenal city of Highland Park, Michigan, under the auspices of the Honorable Mayor Glenda McDonald. And before we get started, just want to give a thanks to all those that came out last week. We had a phenomenal program last Saturday morning over at New St. Paul Church, and it was hosted by the Black Brickmasters, and we had a great time for about 3 hours that morning and afternoon, and we helped to lift up Black men and Black women, you know, in the village that we all are a part of. So I just want to thank everybody for coming out and braving the weather that day to help us to go and celebrate the young Black men and the young Black women that have to live together in peace, in harmony, and in love with each other. Also, too, I just want to say to those that are running, as many of you know, there is a special election that's going on today in Districts 25 and District 13. And that's in the cities primarily of Westland, Wayne, Canton, and Dearborn Heights in District 25. And I believe it's in the cities predominantly in the Warren area in District 13. But again, I just want to say to everyone that goes out and is supporting candidates in that district or in those districts, please drive safely, be careful, and make certain too that regardless of whatever you do, cast your ballot. Make certain that you get out and support the candidate of your choice. We're not telling you who to vote for. The main thing we're doing is telling you to get out and vote for the candidate of your choice, because you don't want to wake up tomorrow and wish that you had voted and didn't. Lastly, just want to say a little bit, we're going to maybe just touch upon it a little bit. Men and women are just as eager to see some of the sporting events that we've had in the past month. A lot of U of M fans were so happy to see the Wolverines win the national championship in football. And then we had a lot of people. I'm still a Spartan diehard. I'm a graduate of Michigan State. But I do want to congratulate the Wolverines for having a season that culminated in them to bring back the victory to the great state of Michigan and to those that attend the University of Michigan. So again, congratulations to them, as well as it kind of pains me a little bit to, I was thinking that this show was going to be making the announcement that we were going to look forward to the next 2 weeks of celebrating the Lions and making it into the Super Bowl. But we fell a little short by 3 points. And I just want to say to all the fans that we had a great season, the Detroit Lions did. We built a camaraderie around each other, supporting the Lions, supporting the victories, and encouraging them even after the losses. But now this is a time that we want to encourage them, because even though they may have fell short this past Saturday, or Sunday rather, but we hope and pray that they can still rebuild on this. We hope that a lot of the pieces that were available for them to enact a great game on Sunday are still in place. We hope that we don't lose a lot of players. We hope that we don't lose a lot of coaches. We know usually things are inevitable, but greatness usually encourages greater things from that point. But again, those that may want to go and say that there was do some Monday morning quarterbacking, saying that there should have been field goals that were kicked rather than went for it on fourth and whatever the yards that they had to do. We still had a great season. We did. Hindsight, there may be some people that may be thinking, well, they should have, you know, woulda, coulda, shoulda, woulda. But the bottom line is that we accomplished something that we haven't seen in the city of Detroit in decades. My hat goes off to all of the participants in the game on Sunday, to the coaches, and to the owners for assembling a great, great nucleus of players and coaches for the Detroit Lions. Next year, we hope that we'll be greater, we hope that we'll be better, and we hope that we'll be able to go and next year make it to the Super Bowl, and not just make it in the Super Bowl, but to be able to win it. Again, congratulations. My hat goes off to the Detroit Lions for having a great, great, great season that really picked up the spirits of a lot of people. And I have not heard so many men and women galvanized around a sporting team since we had the Bad Boys, since we had the Detroit Pistons that won with Chauncey and Rip and Ben Wallace, as well as the Bad Boys back during the Isaiah Dumars, Bill Laimbeer, Rick Mahorn, those days, Vinnie Johnson, so the Microwave. So, you know, we've had some great teams, including the Red Wings, Steve Yzerman. And we've had some great baseball teams. I mean, you know, Alan Trammell, Lou Whitaker, Sparky was our coach at the time. So the Lions are due, and we hope and pray that they will get theirs in the very, very near future. Okay, my special guest today is Miss Alicia Johnson. She's the executive director of Emergent Justice. And Alicia, I know that we've talked a little bit about the Lions before the show. So if there was any comment that you wanted to make, and it's good to hear a female's perspective about what they thought pertaining to how the Lions did as well. You're on.
So I just want to say that, you know, I love Detroit. I'm not a native Detroiter. I am originally from Kalamazoo.
But I've been living here for the past 4 years, and I just want to say the Lions are a Michigan team, and the fans come from all over the state. So Detroit has to share the Lions with the rest of the state. But I just want to say I've been a fan for many years, and I've been a fan through our ups and downs, mostly downs, right? And this year was the most exciting year that I've watched in a long time, and I just want to thank not only the players but the fans. We are some loyal folks. We fill up that arena even when our team is losing, and we want to see them win. And so I think, you know, although we came so close, I don't want to get too down, because I also believe that we had some good rookies. And I think we have a really good coach, and he's put together a really good team. The general manager's put together a really awesome team, and I'm really excited about seeing where they're going to go, because they've grown, right? Like last year, they won a few games, right? And then this year, we made it to the championships, and never have we ever gotten this close, right?
Last year, we did not control our destiny, because we were just so close to getting into the playoffs, but we needed some help to get into the playoffs. This year, we controlled our own destiny. Only thing that we just were not able to do was control where in the playoffs we were going to be positioned at. Yeah. But we made the playoffs. That's the important part compared to years past. We were hoping that another team would win, another team would lose, and we couldn't control that destiny.
I'm just going to say that Cowboys lost. That Cowboys loss.
Well, there's a lot of people that really kind of feel like that was a game that was taken from us.
I believe so.
The Cowboys are sitting at home watching who's going to compete in the Super Bowl, as well as a lot of other teams are watching the same thing. But again, my head goes off to the two teams that made it in the Super Bowl, the Kansas City Chiefs, as well as the San Francisco 49ers. Now, let me ask this last quick question before we get to, you know, our topic. Do you have any predictions for the Super Bowl?
I don't know, but Taylor Swift up in that. I don't know if she does something. I think she got some kind of magic going on.
Well, she's definitely encouraging the fans of Kansas City to come out and support her man, Kelce, as well as the rest of the team. So we'll see if that transcends into a win,
we'll see.
For them. But then at the same time, too, this is they're able to repeat, because you know they were the champions last year. So there's a possibility they could repeat and be a repeat champion this year.
Yeah, but we beat them once. So
well, that was the thing, because we beat them the first game. Even though there were people that put an asterisk next to that win and said that it wasn't really a true win, because Kelce and I think a couple other star players did not play in that game. Yeah. But a win is still a win.
Whether or not
Magic played in a game. And if he didn't play in a game, if you beat the L.A. Lakers minus a Magic Johnson, minus Kareem, minus a Kobe, it was still a win, even though they are great players. But still in all, you still have great players that also play along with them as well.
Detroit fans, we want all of our wins. So we logged that as a win, and it was legitimate.
Absolutely. Well, let's get to our topic then. Primarily, the thing is that what is, just real quick, just tell a little bit about what emergent justice is, and then we'll kind of go into the other topics that we're going to talk about today.
So emergent justice is a collective of volunteers, directly impacted folks, and people that have loved ones that are fighting to end mass incarceration.
Mm-hmm.
We do criminal justice reform work, and our work really stems from something we do called participatory defense. And it's a way that we take action. It is mutual aid, in a sense, where it is us helping folks navigate the system, the criminal legal system, that don't understand it. We are a help to the defense lawyers who are supporting these constituents moving through the criminal legal system, and we are researchers. Sometimes we're investigators, but we're not lawyers. We're just regular everyday citizens that are directly impacted by the system or have been, and have loved ones in the system that we're fighting for. And we do this as a way to bring together people who have been harmed by the system, and as another way for them, once we help them, to join us and then give back. And that's how we grow.
Okay.
But yeah, participatory defense is really the foundation of our work.
And if anybody would like to get more information about Emergent Justice, can you give your contact on the website?
Yeah, so check us out at emergentjustice.org. That is emergentjustice.org. You can also check us out on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok.
Okay, okay. Now, let's talk about interrogation techniques on children and individuals with learning disabilities. Tell a little bit about what is it that, what can be some of the long-term psychological effects of using read interrogation techniques?
Yeah. So through participatory defense, we continue to get people who were wrongfully convicted. And we would get cases where people, you know, we just couldn't understand, like, why this was really happening to them. Mm-hmm. And then my son actually is wrongfully convicted, sitting in a Kalamazoo jail right now for over a year. And let me tell you what read interrogation is first. It's a type of interrogation that is invented by a man named John Reed. And it's been really slowly coming over fire the last few years, because it is the most used law enforcement, method that we feel is wrong. And it is the reason why people confess to things that they don't do. What it really is a behavior analysis model. And it's used to identify when people are lying, mm-hmm. rather than actually finding the evidence, right? So if we're using this tool, then it means that we're not actually using our detective tools, right? Like actually looking and doing investigating. And it's like they're trained to become human lie detectors, and it's very inaccurate. It's been proven to be very inaccurate. Police tend to mistakenly focus on the truth of the suspect instead of the actual evidence that has been, you know, found or detected or whatever. And once they've said that this person is their person who they feel is not innocent, they then tend to focus on that person instead of the actual evidence. And so there's a loss of
there's a loss of a due process,
yes.
to try and go into more detail,
exactly.
into finding out, investigating who actually could have also been culpable of whatever that crime was as well. Because
yes.
it could have been multiple people as opposed to just one person.
Exactly.
Okay.
And what we just recently found is not only are they teaching this technique to police, but they do it to school administrators as well. And school administrators get a credit for actually being taught to interrogate our children. Now, we know that there's a serious issue with that, because children in school, if your child is in school, the person overseeing your child is the administrators, the principal, the vice principal,
mm-hmm.
The superintendent is responsible for your child.
Mm-hmm.
And in that moment, your child can be interrogated by any administrator, and this can actually lead to a police case. The potential long-term physical effects on using READ is that children, especially with learning disabilities, can increase their anxiety, their trauma, and it can have a negative impact on their trust levels. These techniques may also lead to an individual not having a good mental health well-being. Additionally, folks that have learning disabilities like myself, it can exacerbate the psychological impact of these interrogation techniques, especially with folks that really don't understand the questions or have a problem, putting things together in a timeline. it can be very, very harmful to, I guess, try to navigate your way in a conversation with someone who you already feel has power over and authority over you as well.
So when you say in terms of, say, with the school, so if something happens in the school to a young person in the school, are they not giving the due process to really find out what was, you know, what all happened, who all might have been the persons that perpetrated whatever that was that somebody's being accused of?
Well, let me give you an instance. There is a 9-year-old young man, young black child, and he's playing pretty rough, right? Mm-hmm. And he gets suspended and actually expelled because of this rough play.
Mm-hmm.
And the teacher involved did not agree. But after actually having a conversation with the 9-year-old young man, whatever he told them was the reason why he was actually expelled.
Mm-hmm.
But he was only roughhousing, like young children tend to do.
Mm-hmm.
And because his parent didn't know that he had been interrogated, because that's what that was. His parent didn't know that he was being questioned in any way, didn't know what the questions were. And now this young child doesn't want to talk about what's happened. And it's been really hard for us to actually figure out what he told them.
But, you know, the thing that's so interesting, because they tell you in terms of, say, they read you your Miranda rights.
Mm-hmm.
But then what do they do in the schools? Now
in the school, you aren't getting no Miranda rights read to you because you're not under arrest.
So when the child goes in front of the principal or whoever the administrators are in the school, they're pretty much like subjected to whatever they say that might be videotaped. That's it. So yes. They don't have an attorney present to kind of counsel them on what to, what not to say.
And why it's coercion is because what folks are taught to do is to actually lie to you. So I can say, well, I saw you kick, you know, little Tony. And the kid's like, no, well, it's on video. We have you on video. And so now it's like, if you just tell us that you kicked Tony, then we'll work this out for you. You just tell us that you kicked him.
So you're saying that they may encourage them to say something that didn't happen and letting them think that they may be getting off a lot easier than what they could be if they didn't admit mm-hmm. that they did something like that.
And these are techniques that are taught to get down to the bottom of a story. Right. And stories, I think, are the heart of especially black people. We all have such rich stories that we come from. And so we tell stories a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And what this technique is used to do, I think, is to break that spirit of storytelling in a sense, where you tell this story and that's not the story they want to hear. So you make up another story for them so that you can have that anxiety stop. You can have that feeling of someone overcoming you or overpowering you stop in the moment. You're not thinking about what these answers to these questions are going to mean later on. You're just thinking about now. In the case of my son, who was told that, give us something, and then we'll let you go, and this will all go away. And he was like, okay, maybe this. They're like, no. Then he was like, well, maybe this scenario. And I think what it does is it just breaks a person's soul, especially someone who already has, you know, cognitive issues or might have mental health issues, right? And who are actually questioning themselves, right? It's a sense of gaslighting in a way, right? It's, them just telling you lies to get you to say something, and it's legal.
So in the few minutes that we have, what can be done about this?
So I think one of the biggest things that we ask for is a different model, and it's called PEACE. And the PEACE method is called preparation, planning, engage, explain, account, and closure. with an evaluation, right? And that's what PEACE stands for. And under the PEACE method, investigators are allowed to tell a suspect his, or to let a suspect tell their story without interruption. Mm-hmm. And before presenting the suspect with any other inconsistencies or contradictions between the story, they let a person tell what actually happened. Instead of presenting them with, tactics that pull answers from a person.
So to not go in and tell them what the consequences could be. So rather than for them to deal with the consequences, thinking, okay, well, if I hurry up and tell them what they want to hear, then they may let me out mm-hmm. early.
Yeah.
Or they may give me only a couple of months punitive measures versus years of punitive measures
yes.
against something.
Yeah, exactly.
So you're saying that it's the PEACE method. That's the one that you would think that they should be. And this is not just in the schools, but this is also law enforcement as well.
Yes. And we actually, as taxpayers, pay for these trainings to happen all over our state. The Reed office is actually located in Chicago, Illinois, and they've had a lot of pushback around their methods. Mm-hmm. And we are here to ask them to, you know, not push these tactics on our communities. And so we're asking our sheriff's offices to discontinue these trainings. And we're also asking our school administrators to discontinue these trainings as well.
So we've got a couple minutes left. So what then, Ms. Johnson, would you like to see the average person to do? I mean, is there like, write your legislators, or what is it that you, what method would you like to see people to do?
So I think what we really want to do is we're starting conversations. Mm-hmm. We've done a 3-part series explaining Reed and its harm. We've also brought in experts who've been working on this issue for many years to talk about it and inform our community. Because first, you have to understand how it's harmful to you and everyone around you. And so what we would like is for people to join us. We have a call that we do. It is a Zoom call, so you can show up. But we're going to start to do some in-person stuff where we're doing a road show, in a sense, where we're going around and we're actually in our stage of like sharing and being like, I guess we call ourselves town callers, where we actually share information and we're saying, hey, you all, this is here. This is, you know, happening to us, and this is harmful to our communities and our kids.
Okay. We've got a couple seconds left. Give the contact information again, that if they'd like to join or they'd like to get more information, what they do.
Yes, so please check us out. You can check us out at emergentjustice.org, emergentjustice.org, and we are on Facebook, we're on Instagram, and we are also on TikTok. You can find us at info@emergentjustice.org as well.
Okay, thank you again. We are live today, and if you'd like to get a copy of the Detroit Native Sun newspaper, who sponsors our show, contact Ms. Valerie Lockhart, 313-457-5944. And if you'd like to advertise, you can contact her as well. Again, have a great rest of this day. Drive safely in this snow, and make certain, whatever you do, if you do and live in a district where you can vote, vote.
Here at the Full and Fabulous Curvy Girl Project, we don't just focus on health, beauty, and self-esteem. We also offer an amazing summer program for young ladies ages 12 to 18. For more information, visit our website at fullandfabulous.org. See you soon.